Hello everyone, to the first higher level part of our study of the central dogma of biology. Specifically, right now we're looking at DNA transcription in topic 7.2. And as you can see from this image right here, you have DNA, which has been unzipped by RNA polymerase, and an mRNA strand is being made that is complementary to the antisense strand of DNA. Anyway, we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, so let's dive straight in to that first assessment statement about transcription, namely that it occurs in the 5' to 3' direction. What that means is that while transcription is happening, RNA polymerase can only add new nucleotides to the 3' end of an existing mRNA strand. So just like for DNA replication, the enzyme can only work in the 5' to 3' direction, and we are talking about the new strand, not the old strand. So it's working in the 5' to 3' direction of the new strand, adding 3 nucleotides to the already existing 3' end. Now, as a quick reminder, the sense strand is the one that has more or less the same base sequence as the transcribed mRNA, except that all the thymines are replaced by uracil, all the T's are U's. The antisense strand is complementary to the sense strand. It's the other strand of DNA. As such, it's also complementary to the mRNA strand. And it's this strand, the antisense strand, that the RNA polymerase will actually read to make the mRNA. So it's acting as the template for transcription. Now, here we can see that as an image, where we have the sense strand, the antisense strand, and here we have the mRNA being built in the 5' to 3' direction. Again, that means it's the opposite for the antisense strand, but the mRNA and the sense strand are going in the same direction and will basically have the same sequence. We can actually see that here, where we have the sense strand and the RNA, where except for the T's and U's being different, everything else is the same. So the sense strand reading TAC, TG, CC, TA, etc. Both the sense strand and the mRNA are complementary to the antisense strand. And here we have RNA polymerase adding new nucleotides that are complementary to the antisense strand. So let's actually start working through the process of transcription. And just like translation, they both have 3 main steps: initiation, elongation, and termination. Now, initiation is how transcription actually starts. So, basically, RNA polymerase will bind to a section of the DNA called a promoter. That's something that helps the RNA polymerase bind. And once it has attached to the DNA at the promoter region, the RNA polymerase enzyme is going to be able to find the antisense strand, find the start of the gene, and also know which direction to read it, because it's on the antisense strand and moving to add RNA nucleotides in the 5' to 3' direction. So a little note that the promoter region is an example of a section of DNA that doesn't code for anything. It's not technically a gene. It does not code for a heritable characteristic. That said, it is part of the DNA. So promoter region is one of those unread parts of DNA. But it is very important. We know why it's there. So again, during initiation, RNA polymerase will attach to the promoter. And then it's going to read the antisense strand during elongation before popping off when it reaches the terminator in termination. So, initiation. The RNA polymerase unwinds the DNA by breaking the hydrogen bonds between the 2 strands, attaching to the promoter region, and then starts to read the antisense strand. Complementary RNA nucleotides are going to pair with that open side of DNA, basing what they are on the DNA, using the RNA nucleotides A, G, C, and U. So, Here we're starting elongation. Initiation was when RNA polymerase attached to the promoter region and unzipped or unwound the DNA, breaking the hydrogen bonds between the two strands. And in elongation, we're going to see it add nucleotides to the 3' end of the mRNA molecule. So again, in elongation, RNA polymerase is forming those covalent phosphodiester bonds between the nucleotides. Just like in DNA replication, it's actually getting the energy from this, because technically it's not adding nucleotides, it's adding nucleoside triphosphates, which have a third phosphate group, just like ATP. If you break it off, it provides the energy. That said, that's more than you need to know. Really, thinking of elongation as RNA polymerase adding RNA nucleotides together in the 5' to 3' direction by complementary base pairing on the antisense strand is good enough. And again, working in the 5' to 3' direction of the RNA strand and reading the antisense strand using complementary base pairing. So here we see it going, adding those free ones. Wherever there is a T in the DNA, it will code for an A. Where there's a G, it will code for a C. Where there's a C, it will code for a G. And where there's an A, it will code for a U. Those are the complementary base pairing rules. And again, the mRNA strand is built up because the RNA polymerase is moving along the antisense strand of the DNA, slowly making the mRNA bigger and bigger and bigger. And this continues until termination. In termination, the RNA polymerase reaches the terminator region and stops. Now the mRNA is complete, which means the RNA polymerase will pop off the DNA, and the mRNA is released from the antisense strand, eventually floating out of the nucleus to be read by ribosomes in translation. Now note that in prokaryotes, this mRNA is ready to go. Prokaryotes do not have introns and exons. But in eukaryotes, those introns will need to be removed. So let's go through it all one more time. We have the gene with a promoter on one end and a terminator on the other. In initiation, RNA polymerase binds to the promoter and unwinds the DNA. During elongation, it reads the antisense strand, adding RNA nucleotides in the 5' to 3' direction, forming covalent bonds between them, and using the complementary base pairing rules, A to U, T to A, G to C, C to G, to make mRNA. This continues until it reaches the terminator, when the RNA polymerase pops off, and the mRNA is complete. So, a little animation of this can be seen here, where we can see the promoter region, the coding region that codes for DNA, and the terminator. The RNA polymerase will attach to the promoter region and unwind the DNA. That's initiation. It then goes to the beginning of the gene and starts doing elongation, where it reads the antisense strand moving in the 5' to 3' direction of the mRNA nucleotide, reading the antisense strand and using complementary base pairing rules, A to U, T to A, G to C, and C to G. This continues with only the part that the RNA polymerase is reading unwound until the RNA polymerase reaches the terminator. When it reaches the terminator region, the finished mRNA pops off, and the RNA polymerase pops off, and the DNA winds back shut. This RNA is now going to be edited by cutting out all of the introns. So, initiation, RNA polymerase unwinds and unzips the DNA, attaching to the promoter region, and reading the antisense strand. Elongation, using the antisense strand as a template to make an mRNA strand from these nucleotides building the mRNA in the 5' to 3' direction using base pairing rules. Until termination, when the RNA polymerase reaches the terminator and releases the mRNA and pops off the DNA, allowing the DNA to rewind shut. Initiation, elongation, and termination. Now, again, After termination, this mRNA is not yet 100% done in eukaryotes. The introns still need to be cut out. So eukaryotic cells do modify their mRNA after transcription. The pre-mRNA that's not 100% done yet still has those introns, whereas mature mRNA has the introns cut out. And really, this involves cutting out all of the introns and stitching all of the exons together. We can see here the DNA has some parts that are introns and some parts that are exons. Now, when that actually gets transcribed, both the introns and exons are transcribed. So, an enzyme is going to need to identify the edges and then cut out the intron, attaching the exons together. So, doing this allows an organism, our cells, to increase the number of proteins it can make. Not only can they take out introns, but they can also remove some of the exons to make different combinations of exons and make different proteins. So again, they can remove some of the exons. They usually don't, but they can. So for example here, if you have a DNA strand that was transcribed into an mRNA strand with these five different exons, all the introns between them will always get removed. However, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, the exons, can be all included in the final protein to make this big protein with alpha helices and beta pleated sheets, etc. Or maybe they skip number 3, so this purple part is missing and you get this protein, which has a different function. Or they could skip number 4 and get this protein with a different shape and a different function. So again, by actually editing the mRNA after transcription, but before translation, your body can make way more proteins from the same amount of DNA. In fact, we make about somewhere between 4 to 10 times, we're still not sure, but 4 to 10 times the number of proteins than the number of genes we have in our DNA. And that's very impressive. Speaking of that, remember that we are emergent organisms, where our cells, which all have the same type of DNA, have specialized, have differentiated to serve very different purposes. And this really is all because of gene expression. Which exons, which genes are being used, and which ones are not. So gene expression, which genes are turned on and which ones are turned off, are regulated by proteins that bind to the DNA. And really, transcription is affected by two types: transcription factors and regulatory proteins. Transcription factors are actually needed for transcription. They help tell mRNA where the promoter region is, and they attach to those sequences and help catch RNA polymerase that's floating around in the nucleus. Meanwhile, those regulatory proteins can either increase or decrease the rate of transcription, and those that increase it are enhancers, while those that decrease it are silencers. So again, we have here all this DNA, and there are different promoters and control elements that affect how much things get transcribed, either at moderate levels, high levels, or very low levels, depending on whether they have normal transcription factors, promoters, or silencers. That said, really all you need to remember is that gene regulation is controlled by proteins that can either enhance transcription by helping RNA polymerase attach to it, or lower transcription by preventing RNA polymerase from attaching to it. And one of the easiest ways to prevent RNA polymerase from attaching to a DNA sequence is by figuring out how tightly wound up the nucleosomes are. Again, eukaryotic DNA is wrapped twice around 8 histone proteins with an H1 linker to make a nucleosome. However, those histone proteins technically have little legs and, or tails, it's a better word, that help tighten the DNA. And the more tightly packaged the DNA is, like here, the less it's actually going to get transcribed and the less it's going to make proteins. And different cells will either tighten or loosen the nucleosomes to help transcribe different proteins based on their function, whether they're a nerve cell, a neuron, a muscle cell, a skin cell, etc. And when they're tightening it, they're technically methylating it. When they're loosening it, they're acetylating it. Not words you necessarily need to know. Methylation, yes, but acetylation, not as much. And again, really, different cell types have different parts of their DNA that are tightly packed. This means that some genes are going to be read more than others, which allows the different cells in your body to differentiate as needed by your body. In fact, some parts of DNA remain permanently supercoiled in some of your cells because they never get read. And what's kind of cool is that by analyzing which parts of your DNA are tightly packaged, you can actually figure out some things about a person. So more and more, we're studying the methylation or the tightness of DNA. Now, the methylation can be of the nucleosomes, it can also be directly of the DNA, but basically, the more methylation, the tighter those tails on the nucleosomes, so the tighter the DNA, which means that a gene is expressed less and less and less. And we can study how different parts of your DNA are read more or less at different times in your life. So different people may look different because of this. It's called epigenetics, the expression of your genetics. Different people may look different because of epigenetics rather than their actual DNA. The same people may have the same DNA that's being read differently because of the environment. And indeed, the environment of a cell and of an organism has an impact on gene expression. You have to know that. We are not just our nature, our DNA. It's also nurture, the environment we grew up in. DNA methylation patterns change over the course of your lifetime, and it's not entirely determined by your DNA. Identical twins with exactly the same DNA will have different methylation patterns. Their DNA will be tighter or looser in different places, which means that they're using and making different proteins. And that gets us back into that proteome versus genome thing. Now, different cell types as well in your own body have different methylation patterns. And as you're growing, environmental factors affect which parts of your DNA are methylated or tighter. So, for example, which parts of DNA you read as you're developing as a baby, when you're pregnant, when you're a baby, a young adult going through puberty, or an older person. And really, those methylation patterns change your DNA, and those changes in your environment change the expression of your DNA, which genes are being read and which ones are not. Stress in your life can do this. And for example, if your mother was ever starving, that will change which proteins get read in your body, because the methylation patterns in your DNA will be permanently changed, even if you're not starving. You will have a lower metabolism, preparing your body for the starvation your mother endured. Meanwhile, if you had a great diet your whole life, your child will have a different methylation pattern to help them cope with that environment, even though they have the same DNA. Here are some other examples of different gene expression. Hydrangeas are a type of flower that will change the color they make based on the pH of the soil in which they grow. The more acidic it is, the more blue they are. The more alkaline or basic it is, the more pink they are. Himalayan rabbits will change the color of their fur, so literally which proteins they make to color their fur depending on the temperature. When it is more than 35 degrees Celsius, they grow white fur, which helps them reflect more light and stay cooler. When it's less than 30 degrees Celsius, they grow black fur, which helps them absorb more light, because black absorbs all the colors, all the wavelengths, and helps them stay warmer. And we can actually change their fur because of this. If we take a rabbit and strap an ice pack to its back, when we remove the ice pack, the fur underneath will be black, and a bit longer as well. If we keep a rabbit in a warm environment, all the fur will be white, like this one. So this rabbit was raised in temperatures above 30 degrees Celsius. Breeders who want to sell more expensive rabbits that have these cute black ears and black feet and black nose will actually raise them at less than 20 degrees Celsius, and then just those parts of the body will turn black, because those are the parts with the lowest surface area to volume ratio, and thus, highest surface area to volume ratio, and thus will get the coldest, like our fingers are always cold, rabbits' ears are always cold. And that means it, the fur there turns black. Another example, fish. Some fish and reptiles will actually change from being male to female depending on their environment. For example, Nemo, realistically, when his wife died at the beginning of the movie Finding Nemo, in real life, he would have turned into a girl, which changes it a little, right? That changes the story. So when the dominant female dies, the dominant male here will turn into a dominant female. And a new male will grow to be the non-dominant but biggest male. And again, if the female dies, the biggest male turns into a female. One more example from humans. Depending on the amount of sunlight your skin receives, your cells will make different amounts of melanin, which is what causes you to tan. The more sunlight, the less methylated your DNA to make melanin is, so the more it's transcribed, and the more that gene for darker skin is expressed. The darker skin helps prevent skin cancer. Though, of course, too much sunlight increases skin cancer, so be careful there. Okay, we're done with 7.2, talking about transcription and gene expression. Again, those assessment statements on gene expression beyond transcription are that splicing of mRNA can increase the number of proteins an organism can produce by removing introns and changing which exons are being used. Gene expression can be regulated by proteins that attach to the DNA. Some enhance it, and some silence DNA. And specifically, some of this has to do with how tight the DNA is packed around nucleosomes. The tighter they are, or the more methylated they are, the less DNA is read. And we can actually analyze this to see which proteins are being used. However, the environment affects gene expression, how tight the nucleosomes are, which parts of the DNA remain supercoiled. And those supercoiled parts never get transcribed, so their proteins are never made. Okay, we are done with 7.2. Have a wonderful day. Ciao!